celebrating history in a book club. I'm honored and pleased that David Luke was willing to walk all the way from his place of work. and to enlighten us on the book, we know this is going to be a wonderful way to end the book club year. After all, we all know that every woman needs a book club. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm here under false pretenses. I don't know anything about other book clubs. To be honest with you, in order to talk about history of book clubs, I'd have to be able to compare them, wouldn't I? And you know as well as I do, there isn't any other book club in the United States that's like you. No other book club in the United States did what you did within a matter of a few years of being created in the first place. At the risk of sounding melodramatic, one of the most powerful moments I ever had on a trip abroad was in the crypt of St. Paul's Cathedral when I was looking for Christopher Wren's monument. And of course it says on his tomb, which is very self-effacing, way down in the corner, "If you're looking for my monument, look around you." Your monument, your living monument, is the Everett Public Library in all of its facets and all the different ways that it serves this community. It exists only because of you. If the organization hadn't refused to take no for an answer from the politicians of the day, and in the teeth of the worst economic conditions, not just once or twice, but three or four times, insisted that your priority, which was to provide a free public library for this community, was going to happen, and you were going to make it happen. And the more that people insisted that you would have to make it happen alone, the more you did exactly that. So the story, more like a melodrama that should be played out with some kind of a soap opera, because it's exactly that, is that at each point, something happens that looks so unlikely that you're thinking they made that up just to keep the story rolling. The fact is that from the very, very beginning, this club, the raison d'etre for your club was to create a public library for Everett, Washington. That was your declared purpose. And from the very beginning, we're about to celebrate, it's not the right word, we're about to observe the 100th anniversary of the shootout of the Everett City Dock. And when the exchange down there is repeated, the litany of exchanges between the deputies and the demonstrators, there's a line where the sheriff tells them you can't land here, and somebody on the boat says, "The hell we can." About the first time that you met the city council back in the 1890s, under the old charter, that very first charter that the city had, that was essentially what you told them in a very polite way. And embroidering it with quotes of poetry from all over the place. And constantly citing examples of such magnitude that I think the council was stunned. The Boston Public Library, of course, was the grandest library project of the late 19th century. And you looked it out to make allusions to the Boston Public Library. And frequently, when the going got tough, somebody would break out their volume of Oliver Wendell Holmes' poem on the dedication of the Boston Public Library. And the city council is sitting there trying to figure out how in the world we can achieve something the likes of Meet with Him and White's masterpiece in a town where we're just laying off police officers and don't even have a paid fire department quite yet. The answer to the problems that you confronted never seemed to have gone to the club. And so you continued to meet until you eventually achieved, in rather short order actually, achieved what it was that you said you needed to achieve. And of course your practice field for all this was creating a hospital out of the same sort of public spirit and gossamer and lack of public funding that allowed you to do that. Immediately before you went to city council and said, we need a library, you said, we need a hospital, and we're going to build it, and it's going to happen, and it did. So when I'm trying to think about all the things that we said about you, it gets confused with all the things that get said about us. Because anytime we receive a compliment for what's going on here, anytime a child or a parent or anybody else comes in here and walks out complimenting us on what they like about this place, and we get a lot of compliments, I'm thinking those compliments really need to be directed to you, because you are the living legacy of the women who, back in 1894, raised hell until they got the book club, the library that they needed to support the book club that they figured was inadequate in itself. Not enough to have your own book club. You have to be sure that the rest of the community also gets involved in that literacy and that access to the culture of the place, to that sense of neighborhood, to that sense of association. It can only result by having a free public library. I want to talk a little bit about 1894. I want to talk a little bit about, maybe we kill this thing, about a lady who's just turning 100 up in the Northwestern, and it's the oldest piece of art that the city of Everett owns. She was given to us by the family of one of the engineers that laid out the town site of Everett back in the 1890s, in 1893 and 1894. And she was given to us in 1916. A great year to receive a gift, because of course that's the year that left the biggest scars on our reputation, the greatest amount of emotional baggage to deal with, the industrial violence that resulted in the bloodiest labor confrontation in Northwest history. But this wonderful sculpture turns up in the library board minutes as having been called Hela. Unknown sculptor involved a beautiful bronze, a lovely piece of work. If you haven't seen her, come up and see her. She's in the Northwest room. And she's actually, the name of the sculpture is not really known. It was by a sculptress from Vienna by the name of Hela Unger, and was done just a little over 100 years ago. And she's a remarkable example of all the interesting and exciting stuff that was going on in Vienna just before the First World War. I myself have a note that looks right here. Excuse the old cat, but I discovered when I was starting to put this together that a lot of the images that are my favorite images are images that I've been showing in this auditorium for a couple of years now. We just had the 39th anniversary of the Northwest Room in March, and during that time period, frequently we've drawn from old images, including this Herman Seward photograph taken on Washington's birthday party at the Monte Cristo Hotel. Big success. In order to get in, you had to bring a book. And they're all dressed like ladies of the colonial period. And they're all standing in the little octagon that was the base of the tower on the southwest corner of the facade of that hotel that was torn down back in 1924 and 1925. Most of the important ladies of the club are there. A couple of them are missing. Alice Baird isn't there. Her mother was involved in some medical problems that required her to go back to Chicago, and so she wasn't there for the picture. Mr. Seward used a flash powder illumination to capture all the ladies early in the morning. As a matter of fact, the Grigny family still treasures the billing from Mr. Seward for the original photograph and the individual prints that he made from this. We've only ever found, I think, two of Herman Seward's gold tone chloride prints that survived, but a wonderful photograph. Rare photograph of the inside of the hotel as well. And of course, their intent was to try to do what they'd done just a few months earlier, which was to actually create a hospital facility out of good intentions. And in record time, they did exactly that. and had it up and operating all entirely with volunteer labor and donated materials. And so they turned their attention to the book club issue. It was actually in Mrs. Brown. She's kneeling second from the right in the dark dress with the light cap, and she's second from the right in the front row. Mrs. Brown lived down in the Riverside, and one of the meetings of just a lot of the women in the photograph before they organized into a book club and knew each other from the hospital effort, they were discussing recipes for jams and jellies, the story goes, and discovered that they thought there was another recipe that was required for their community, which was to have a decent library so that everybody could enjoy the quality of literature that they enjoyed because they are of a more upward mobile socio-economic strata. And of course, that story that begins in the summer of 1894 comes all the way forward to the building that we have here, dedicated to the public in 1934, still an architectural landmark in the community and the Pacific Northwest, from Carl Gould's masterpieces, sort of the modern industrial counterpart to the Gothic Library at the University of Washington. Job up here in Everett. Of course, we've had the pleasure of bringing it back to look a great deal the way it did when it was completed back in the early years of the Depression. Briefly, you know the story, right? You all know about this. Charles Lewis Colby, the head of the Wisconsin Central Railway, a man of considerable wealth, one of the profound supporters of Brown University, was trying to find the exact spot where Jim Hill's soon-to-be-constructed Great Northern Railway would first hit the Pacific Rim. He knew an English immigrant who was everything that he wasn't, a man who pulled himself up by his own bootstraps, who came over as an infant in arms from Lancashire, England, who worked cruising timber and nearly shot his leg off at one point in an accident cruising timber in the woods of Wisconsin. Eventually, when speculation on building this railroad from St. Paul, Minnesota to the Pacific Rim first began to happen, he immediately moved out here to the Pacific Northwest, settled himself in Tacoma, began trying to figure out how he could get in on what was going to happen. So he would have a motto that he shows good people in after dinner speeches. He said that the way to get rich is to find out what people are going to want, get there where it is first, and then sell it to them when they arrive. That was his plan from Everett. And even Mr. Colby, who was a Brown University graduate and has spent a lot of time reading the classics, could not be restrained from quoting his favorite personally penned bit of doggerel, which was, "Everett is the shortest hall between Saltwater and St. Paul." Of course, what both of them had in common was some degree of access to the fortunes of John D. Rockefeller. And what Mr. Rockefeller had was, among other things, a young son who was having serious difficulties in school. John Jr. had focus problems. He had a world of difficulties with his normal classwork. And as it turns out, as they're announcing the efforts of Jim Hill to build a railroad, the lies of two early founders are being formed by an outfit back in New York City that was the Browning School. And when Mr. Hewitt came out here, and Mr. Colby came out here simultaneously and sailed north up the Inside Passage on the steamer Queen of the Pacific, everybody else was looking at glaciers and admiring the wonders of the scenery. And they were discussing, among other things, how they could transform the peninsula where the Great Northern Railroad first touched the Pacific into an industrial metropolis by enormous proportions. They went up to Muir Glacier. John Muir himself was actually in camp on Muir Glacier, Glacier Bay, when he went to Colby, or in an elegant steamship anchored down in Glacier Bay, discussing how to turn the world into an industrial site. And he was up there trying to figure out how to do exactly the opposite. By the time they got back, they had a plan to build a city that they were going to name after Mr. Colby's son. Mr. Colby's son was a contemporary of John D. Rockefeller's son. The two of them both, again, had learning disabilities. The Browning School in New York was actually created to try and deal with a little core group of very wealthy people's children who could not seem to learn the basics of education that were going to be required of them. And Charles Colby and John Jr., as they called him all the time, were buddies in the Browning School and went on to Brown University after that tutelage and became very successful students there. As a matter of fact, by the time that Everett Colby graduated from Brown University, well, here you see him carrying the game ball from the championship season that he led for Brown University in the 1890s. On a pre-law course, he did an excellent job and went on to become a student successfully passed the law degree. So originally, however, the story is that Everett got named after the voracious teenage son of a millionaire because of his appetite. And as a typical teenager, Everett Colby appears to have been demanding everything on the dinner table and seconds of it. And Henry Hewitt defended him as a growing lad with a healthy appetite. And so our city, it may have been an omen of some sort, was named after a hungry teenager who couldn't get enough fast food for himself. The city grew up to be a prominent New Jersey politician, always was a close friend of Junior. John D. Rockefeller Jr., as a matter of fact, visited Everett with Everett Colby on the one time that they actually came through town immediately after graduating from Brown. They encouraged each other through the experience of college life by saying that as soon as they graduated, they were going to jump on a steamboat and start sailing around the world. And they did exactly that. And on their way back through this part of the country, they stopped and stayed for a couple days over on our Rockefeller Avenue, as it turned out, in the home of Everett Colby's uncle. And Everett Colby, at that point, gave the Everett Woman's Book Club a batch of books that he brought with him that he was going to drop off on his father's behalf. His father, by that time, was 70, deceased. And so the library here was originally started with books from the personal collection of the man the town is named after. So the Everett Land Company, of course, was short-lived, the same way that Charles Colby was. So the book club was begun right after all the plans, the best-laid plans, began to unravel. And it's difficult to argue for expenditures from the city when the newly created city wound up without enough money to fund fire protection or police. As a matter of fact, the stories that are associated with early Everett are not stories of industrial splendor so much as stories of the chaos of too many people getting someplace too soon. That's Everett's first saloon, the first of many, on the north side of Hewitt Avenue, precisely where Interstate 5 goes over today. Next to it, these are the first two buildings built on Hewitt Avenue. Webster's Gem Saloon, that's him in the white apron there underneath his awning, north side of Hewitt, between Walnut and Chestnut. And on the left there is a little shop built by a Welsh immigrant by the name of John T. Rogers, who for the rest of his life loved to tell the story of how he sold cigars and tobacco in the front of the shop, but his main career as an undertaker was pursued in the rear of that very same shop. In an article that he wrote in 1907, he said that there was no intention on his part to boom the undertaking trade by selling tobacco products, but that was where he made a lot of his money. Late one night, this story is going to be told with many different permutations, but the basic story is that a drunk from next door at Jim's Saloon went staggering into John T. Rogers' News Depot tobacco shop and undertaking parlor and was demanding a special brand of tobacco. By that time, Mr. Rogers had discovered that he could also make money late at night by allowing people to sleep in empty coffins in the back of the shop and find no other hotel accommodations in the city of Everett. Too many people here, too fast. And that's not enough to go to decent hotel accommodations. And the weather, as usual, was pretty wet. Well, when the drunk got into the store, he wandered back to accompany Mr. Rogers back to get the brand he was looking for, and stumbled in upon half a dozen people decked out in coffins asleep. He made sufficient noise to arouse a couple of them, and of course, when that happened, all hell broke. In the street, squealing that the dead were rising from the coffins in Rogers' undertaking parlor. And Mr. Rogers said it was a great boost to his sales for that day, and then he wished there was some way he could restage it more than once. But people rushing to come to Everett, well, there's a big close-up at the front of the little store where he sold coffins in the back and back of my front. Sadly, this guy, John T. Rogers, is buried in Evergreen Cemetery, but without a headstone. The man who was the first undertaker, Everett, has no marker in his grave. And of course, Everett, through the lens of a photographer with a romantic eye, didn't much resemble the metropolis where a rail meets sail that you and Colby was talking about. Here you see the Snohomish River at the foot of California. Today there's all manner of freeway overpasses going across the top. Whatever. Well, what you see here are cedar canoes of the type that applied these waters for centuries before this picture was taken in April of 1892. One of the wonderful series of glass negatives by Ian Baskerville, Northwest Collection of the Public Library. Spittle's World was seen in the first dramatic performances in Everett. In a warehouse up there, they raised money for their volunteer fire department for the performance of Uncle Tom's Cabin back in the summer of 1892. Of course, the saloon was always a problem for Everett. You couldn't live with it, and you couldn't live without it. Eventually, Everett was trying to solve the problem by making liquor sales illegal as part of a local option, and it was just before the First World War. But the Women's Book Club was competing with some pretty heavy competition for the awkward hours of a working man in Everett. That's not to say that Everett did not have an unusually high interest in purchasing books and reading them. It's interesting that Everett had several bookstores up and functioning within just a couple years of the time the city started. And later on, a Scotsman, for instance, by the name of Adam Hill, was an extremely successful book salesman, both on the Riverside and in the Bayside, with periodicals as well as the latest novels. And he could tell you stories about his actual meetings with Jack London and other writers of the period. But what they couldn't do was get themselves an organized city government because the Rockefeller back group, had failed to get the tidal lands they were after by joining the Everett waterfront. As a result of that, in the spring of 1892, in the same spirit, I like to think that the Women's Book Club decided to make a book club, the local citizens decided to make a city government without really having much in the way of resources to do that. They couldn't incorporate until the Rockefeller group clearly said that they could do that. And so they began to meet in the spring of 1892 in this building at the far end of Hewitt Avenue. And in the same, the hell we can't sort of attitude, created a committee of 21 to govern Everett for a full year, a provisional government that ran entirely on voluntary contributions of the citizenry and operated somewhat effectively for the better part of a year. But of course, it was never really the way everybody wanted it because, well, without money, you really can't have an effective firefighting force. This building on Market Street, now Highland, was destroyed in the first fatal fire. It was after a matter of months after the city began and a full year before the city was incorporated legally. Fiddler at Billy Burton lived upstairs here at King and Baskerville, King's Hotel. And he was the first fire fatality in the city's history, an event that nearly demoralized the local volunteer fire department so badly that they came close to expanding. Fortunately, didn't, and went on to create an estimable firefighting force. 1894, though, the year that the Women's Book Club was created, was mainly memorable to the early settlers of Everett as having been the time when they decided to take the county seat away from Snohomish, and also the year that they launched the biggest ship ever built in the Pacific Northwest. People don't remember now that in October 1894, Everett was famous not for building gigantic airplanes, but for building gigantic ships, or at least one, before the bottom finally collapsed out of what was left of the economy and the company went belly up. Here you can see the whaleback city of Everett, 360 plus feet long, biggest ship ever built in the Northwest, and it's about to be launched not just for commercial reasons, but for political ones. The launch took place the last week of October 1894, just a week or so before the election in which voters in Snohomish County would decide whether Everett or Snohomish would be the county seat. This picture is known as taken by Herman Seward, the same photographer who took the picture of the book club we looked at a little bit earlier. Beautiful ship. First American steamship to go all the way around the globe. First American steamship to the Suez Canal. Some of you may have heard a couple of years back when some divers found the hull of the city of Everett whale back, which had been lost in 1923 in the Gulf of Mexico, on the bottom of the Gulf of Mexico. They failed to be able to determine if the cargo of molasses from Havana was still inside the hull. So the big memory in 1894 was actually the election that immediately followed the launch of the whale back city of Everett. Times were so depressed by that point that people were looking for any sort of diversion they could come up with. And one of those diversions was trying to knock Emery C. Ferguson off his throne. Old Ferg, as he was known, was a Republican from the days when Lincoln was just going into office. You may remember that Snohomishannon was created in January of 1861. That's what, 2 months before Lincoln was actually inaugurated. Ferg was on the right side at the right time. Remember, the Washington Territory had always been a Democratic gig. Ferg arrived just in time for the Republicans to take over. And also for the territorial government to find itself in the awkward position of having created a new county and the only town to speak of that was in that county was Snohomish, or Katyville as it was known, which was a stronghold of Republicans. So what they did was to convince Morris Frost, who was an old hardcore Democrat and served briefly as the clerk of the territorial legislature back in 1853, to come over to the mainland and set up a store and a hotel at a little point of land stuck out in Fort Gardner Bay. Nobody knew how to pronounce the name, but it was something in the vicinity of Mucklekeel, something like that. That was the Democratic stronghold in Snohomish County when it was created in January of 1861. That only lasted about 6 months until Ferguson here could take it away by a vote of 17 to 11, according to one old books that survived in Ferguson's records and now in the manuscripts collection of the University of Washington. Ferg later, in after-dinner speeches, when asked why Snohomish County was created, always said that it was because the territorial legislation discovered to their distress that there were more politicians than there were counties, and made the mistake rather than killing off any politicians to create new counties for the borough. Nasty fight it went on throughout the entire year. Everett had a glee club that went around singing nasty songs about Snohomish. Snohomish never spent much of the tax money that they gathered anywhere except right in Meridian City. And as a result of that, there was a lot of resentment in places. Oh, Stanford has tried to secede from Snohomish County several times. Places that never saw a dime of tax money expended. And so there were old debts, old arguments that went way, way back. On the other hand, Everett was in serious trouble and Ferg knew it. So the Snohomish Eye newspaper had things like this. Auction on sale of the bankrupt city of Everett, Barge Works, Mail Works, Paper Mill, Everett Monte Cristo Railway, must be sold to satisfy creditors. John D. Rockefeller down there in the corner, getting rid of all of his Everett holdings. The saddest part of all this is that basically, it's not that far from being true. All of this is probably pretty much on the money. I love this one where a New York dude in a top hat with a butterfly net is snagging the beautiful courthouse that Snohomish had built at the height of their railroad boom when the Seattle Lakeshore and Eastern was built. And there you can see he's got strings attached to everything and a bear trap labeled the Standard Oil Company attached to his left foot. Again, all the more tragic because it was really quite true. Well, as turned out, Everett pulled more dirty tricks than Snohomish and wound up, even before all the quotes were counted, hiring August Franklin Heide, an architect who was well known as the architect in most of the larger buildings for the Everett Land Company, to design a beautiful courthouse. Everett guaranteed they'd pay for it, and they even set up a really strange bond issue where Clark Park, what we now call Clark Park, was acquired through a city ballot and then. Well, anyway, by the time they got through, they raised the money to provide free real estate and a new courthouse building for Snohomish County without theoretically costing the county taxpayers anything at all. Yeah, Biden was master of many different modes of design. Of course, the beautiful French Chateauesque building that he designed and built in record time. Right where the president this courthouse is still there. It's just had a couple of makeovers, especially after the August 1909 fire that gutted it. It's a great idea if you make red cedar shingles to have some examples of how beautiful they are. They also just burn wonderfully and burn right off the top part of Everett's courthouse. You can see there on the left, they started building annexes by 1909 in mission styles. What they did was, when they rebuilt it, to have Heidi design it in the new California Craftsman Mission style. And of course, that building now in the National Register of Historic Places still stands, albeit apparently principally to cause headaches for the county council. I mentioned that Mrs. Brown, there in the middle, the wife of Christopher C. Brown, it was in her kitchen down in the Riverside that the idea of the Women's Book Club first got started. They were discussing jelly. That would be the official records of your books. Jelly was under discussion. And that moved logically to books. And the next thing you know, they're talking about a club that would provide a library for all people in Everett who couldn't afford to buy their own books. And of course, if the beginnings were modest and humble, very early on, they chose a place to meet that kind of now even represents the grander ambitions of the town's founders. The Hotel Monte Cristo, it opened in November of 1892, designed by Mr. Haydn's business partner, Charles Hove, who was a German architect with a lot of exposure to Carpenter Gothic. A landmark for the 30 years or so that it existed up on the hillside, up on the corner of Pacific and Cromer. And you can see the beautiful veranda that looked out around the bay. That corner there that